We want to thank you for tuning in today to our newest program, Talking It Out. In this newest segment, Pastor David and Lorraine will be discussing such topics as Bible prophecy, current events, and the Word of God. We trust each of you will enjoy today's edition of Talking It Out.
Hey everyone, welcome back to Talking It Out, here today with my dad. And we had a question that came in, a very complicated question for me, so he'll probably do most of the talking. But the question is from Robert. He says, "Hi, Pastor Lankford. Thank you so much for your Talking It Out program. Thanks, Lorray, for your input. I listen to it at work every Friday while having my lunch. Just a quick question. After Christ's return and he gathers the true church to himself, those unbelievers who survive the wrath of God and go into the millennial reign of Christ, and those who are born in the 1,000 years, do they get a chance to be saved?"
Well, Robert, we thank you immensely for your question. Your question is a profound question, a very, very deep theological question, and I'm going to do my best to try to assimilate the scriptures and hopefully bring some understanding about the 1,000-year millennial reign of Christ. That will only begin after Christ returns. The day that Christ returns to the earth will begin the 1,000-year millennial reign of Christ. And so that's a long time.
Yeah.
We know nothing of that time of expanse relative to humanity and the existence of human beings to live that long. And men will have a chance, unsaved men will have a chance to live that long, providing they don't commit any kind of an act that deserves the death penalty.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let me preface this by also saying the church, the body of Christ, every redeemed person will go into the millennial, will have glorified bodies. We're not going to have human bodies like we have now.
Right.
But we're going to have a divine glorified body, just like the body of Jesus Christ. So when you discuss the millennial reign of Christ, you're talking fundamentally about the humanity that is left on the earth and begins to procreate and replenish the earth in that time period.
Right.
Having glorified bodies, there's no need for immortals, which that's what we will be, to procreate, because mm-hmm. we never die.
Right.
This is going to be the natural born people, and the people who do enter into the millennial and survived the wrath of God. That gets difficult to explain because Jesus comes specifically to Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't know how he's going to mete out judgment in his coming. But we know he's going to do it. We'll talk about that in a few moments. But I want to go first of all today to Isaiah chapter 11. And Isaiah is talking about the millennial reign of Christ and how things will proceed in that time period and how life will be. And we're going to go through numerous verses here in the book of Isaiah, Zechariah, etc., to try to help to open one's understanding to these deeper things of God. As I said, I'll do my best. I'm certain that it will not be perfect. And I'm certain that I'll leave some questions unanswered, but I will do my best. As I was telling Jordan this morning, it's in my head, but it's kind of convoluted, you know. So let's go to Isaiah chapter 11. We want to first begin at verse 3. Isaiah chapter 11, verse 3. "And shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. And he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears. But with righteousness shall he judge the poor and reprove with equity." I want you to notice that. "And reprove with equity. For the meek of the earth, and he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. And righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faithfulness the girdle of his reins." So let's begin at verse 3. Isaiah 11, verse 3. "And shall make him of quick understanding." So Jesus Christ is in his glorified supernatural body and being God is going to have perfect understanding. Mm-hmm. I believe the church, the body of Christ, that enters into the millennium and glorified bodies will also have perfect understanding because we're going to receive a body just like Christ. So he's going to have understanding and it's going to be in the fear of the Lord. So in other words, it is a righteous understanding. He shall not judge after the sight of his eyes. Too many times in our humanity, we make judgments by what we see. And what we see is not always what we think we're seeing.
Right, kind of stereotyping.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. And sometimes what we see is not reality. Mm-hmm. It is a sham. It is a subterfuge. We've been set up sometimes in life for people to trick us. Mm-hmm. So we think we see something, but in reality, it was an element of trickery.
Kind of like pulling the wool over their eyes.
Exactly, exactly. There will be none of that in the millennial reign of Christ because Christ will be here physically upon the earth. He will be dwelling in Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. He will be there. And from that point, that's the federal head of his government. It will go out into all the earth. So Isaiah says he will not judge by his eyesight. Why? Because his understanding is perfect. His understanding is so righteous and so godly. So neither will he reprove with the hearing of his ears. He will reprove, but it will not be with rumor,
right,
and innuendo.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we hear stuff all the time. Some of it's true, some of it's not. He's not going to rule with rumor or by what he just heard somebody
right.
say. You know, we hear it all the time. They say, and you have
yeah.
the spill. And then you ask the question, well, who are they?
Well, that's a long grapevine, actually.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's why they say.
And it gets misconstrued.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
That's purposefully done
mm-hmm.
by using the phrase, they say. And so you try to identify the they, it's impossible.
Yeah, because you don't know, really.
Yes, because it's a lot of it's rhetorical jargon.
Mm-hmm.
Many times it's lies. People have added to it, taken away from it. So it's not what it was in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
God will not judge in that manner whatsoever because he is a righteous judge. He's a righteous judge. You know, Abraham understood fully the righteousness of God as best he could as a human being. Because he says in Genesis 17, 25, shall not the judge of all the earth do that which is right? He knew that God would only do that which is right. That's why he said, surely you'll not slay the righteous with the wicked.
Mm-hmm.
He had that much understanding that God, there's no way you're going to do something like this and hinder or hurt or harm, punish righteousness.
Right.
Because you're the righteous judge. You're only going to do that which is
right.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what he did, of course. And he ultimately destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So he will not judge by eyesight. He will not judge by rumor or innuendo or just by his hearing. He will reprove. He will reprove because he has the ability, because he has perfect understanding to say that needs to be reproved.
Right.
That needs to be rebuked. As a parent, you're already understanding that there's times of reproof and there's times of rebuke and there's times that, well, I can't do that because that's not going to work in this matter.
Right.
But God, in his sovereignty, will know exactly how to mete out the reproof and the rebuke. Again, this is not going to be applicable to those who have glorified bodies. Our bodies will be sinless. There'll be no sin nature in us to look at something and it appeal to us, say, well, I'm going to steal that.
Right, no temptation.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That won't exist in us because that nature is gone because our bodies are glorified.
You're basically not human anymore.
In essence,
yeah.
You're not. You're not going to have blood in your body.
Yeah.
You know, when Jesus appeared to the disciples in the 24th chapter of Luke, I believe it's verse 39, they thought they saw a spirit. He said, touch me, handle me, for a spirit hath not flesh and bone
right.
as you see me have. But he never mentioned blood. But he had flesh just like this.
Yeah.
He had bone density, but he never mentions blood. Paul the Apostle says flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. So that blood part will not be there. So how are we alive? The Holy Spirit is coursing through these veins and in our bodies. That's the quickening power of the Holy Ghost.
Wow.
See, and that's what's going to make us alive.
Exactly.
You know, when a person dies, they die because the spirit left the body.
Mm-hmm.
So when the Holy Spirit comes back into the body,
he brings life again.
Life again.
Wow.
So he's not going to judge by his eyesight, neither reprove about after the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness shall he judge the poor. Now that's really unusual in the sense, you mean though Christ is going to be ruling and reigning in the earth, you're going to have poor people.
Yeah.
Now, you would think there would be no such thing as poor. But it will continue on, and the reason being because of humanity. Now, God is a capitalist. He gave one man five talents, one man three talents, one man one talent. If God, people would say, well, if God was fair, they would have all gotten the same thing. No, because God understands.
Yeah, he knew what the outcome would be.
Yeah.
And who was going to use them and who wasn't.
And the one that got the one talent buried it, and Jesus described him as a slothful and wicked servant.
Yeah.
In the 12th chapter of John, when Mary breaks the alabaster box and anoints Christ, Judas Iscariot is very negative. He said, my God, yeah, that's 300 pence of ointment. That could have been sold and given to the poor. Jesus said, the poor you have with you always. Me you don't have with you always.
That's right.
And when you look at what Christ said there, then poor people will enter in and will exist.
Yeah.
I believe up until we go into eternity. Then there, I don't believe there will be poorness in any capacity because all things will be made new. But even in the millennium, God is going to, there's going to be obviously rich people and middle class, and there's going to be poor because he says that here. But with righteousness shall he judge the poor.
Mm-hmm.
Now, think about, he emphasizes judgment and poor. And I thought about that. Is it because maybe poor people will steal? Will they lie to get more?
Right.
You know, I don't know. These are things we don't know. As Paul said, we just know in part some things.
Right.
So it's not that I'm trying to bring in much conjecture. I'm just trying to look clearly, plainly, pristinely at the scriptures and look at it for what it literally says.
Mm-hmm.
It says, but with righteousness shall he judge the poor. Now, however he judges, it's going to be right.
That's right, exactly.
Because it's with righteousness. Yep. So in whatever capacity the poor are judged, it will be right. And reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. So he will reprove. The Hebrew says that he argues for what's right. You know, I believe it may be like in the days of Moses. They're going to bring complicated things to God, Jesus, at the throne, his kingship in Jerusalem, and he will tell them, this is what you have to do. You know, Moses was doing all this work, and Jethro, his father-in-law, realized how cumbersome this had become to him. And he said, you need to get you some men to take some of these smaller tasks off of you.
Right.
And you take the weighty matters and you judge. And the Bible says a measure of the Spirit of God that was on Moses came upon those 70 elders, and they begin to adjudicate the smaller things. See, I believe the church will play a great role in the earth in adjudicating matters. And when it's maybe when it comes to the death penalty in the millennial, God, Jesus will have to judge that.
Yeah.
You know, because he will know, even though I believe with glorified bodies, we will know. But again, he's the judge.
Exactly.
So it keeps the believer from being involved in that part. That person may say, well, you have a glorified body. I'm a human being, and you're judging me because you feel superior to me. Well, God will take that in his own hands, in his own account, and that will be nullified, that animosity between a glorified saint. You know, I don't know how all of these things are going to unfold, but I'm just trying to simply go by what the scriptures are telling us here. It says also here in verse 4, Isaiah chapter 11, verse 4, he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. So let's dissect that for just a moment, because that's a good bit too. He's going to smite the earth with the rod of his mouth. Now, when Christ returns, that's exactly how he comes in Revelation chapter 19, verse 11. John said, and I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. He that sat upon him is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire. On his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no man knew but he himself. He was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed after him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp two-edged sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with the rod of iron. So when Christ literally begins to come out of heaven at his second advent, he immediately begins to execute judgment in the earth. We're told there in 2 Thessalonians 2, 8, he'll consume the Antichrist with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy him with the brightness of his coming. So he's going to come in this great majesty and glory and deity, and it's going to be something the world, no one has ever seen before. Yeah. And again, we, the church, are going to be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, so it won't have the effect on us it's going to have on the mortals. It's going to be different.
Right.
We won't have that fear and consternation.
Exactly.
They're going to have unfathomable anxiety.
Yeah.
You know, what is going on here?
Oh, yeah.
This is unbelievable. So he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth. Remember, John there in Revelation 19, out of his mouth goeth a sharp two-edged sword. He rules with the rod of iron, John says. He's going to rule with the rod of iron. And I always in my mind visualize a piece of 2 foot, 3 foot rebar.
Yeah.
Half inch rebar. You walk into a China shop, you can decimate that whole place in a moment.
Oh, yeah.
That's how he will rule. He will rule with a rod of iron. Now, that's heavy.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the world paints Christ as some passive, weakling, anemic king, when he's King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and the Bible said he will rule with the rod of iron.
Yeah, fiery eyes.
You know, I mean, it ain't nothing to mess with.
No.
Because he's God.
Yeah.
He's God. And, of course, in his ascension, he says to the disciples in Matthew 28:20, or 28:18, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. So Christ clearly says to the disciples, now after my resurrection, I'm ascending back to the Father. I'll be sitting at his right hand. I, Christ, I have all power in heaven. I have all power in earth. Because Jesus came from the Father's bosom. So Jesus is a manifestation of God. You know, in John 14, verse 8, Philip said, show us the Father. Show us the Father. Jesus said, you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So what he's telling Philip is, every attribute, every character, everything about me that you see is exactly like God, because that's where I came from.
Exactly.
Now, I don't want to get into the Godhead and the Trinity here and those things to convolute the matter, but Jesus is all God now. Before, he was part God, part man.
Yeah.
See, so we always use the term, he was all man, he was all God. I'm saying he's part God, part
right.
man.
Right, half and half.
Yeah, they were co-mingled.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as a man, he rode in boats.
Mm-hmm.
As God, he walked on water. As a man, the storms became boisterous, the water breaking upon the ship they were on. But as God, he stepped to the bow of the ship and said, "Peace, be still." Yeah. As a man, he became hungry, he became thirsty. As God, he fed the multitudes.
Yeah.
So he never once, when you read the Gospels, he never once drew on his deity for himself. After the 40-day fast in Matthew 4, Luke 4, it says after the devil tempted him, he afterward thirst. Excuse me. Yes, he afterward thirst, he afterward hungered.
Yeah, because the devil wanted him to turn the stone into bread. Yeah.
So obviously he was drinking water through that time. So at the close of the 40-day fast, hunger returned.
Exactly.
But it doesn't say he thirst, meaning he obviously drank water
His
humanity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So as God, he had all power, but he never used that for himself.
Because, you know, he said, he could have turned the stone into bread.
Absolutely. He could have called down 12 legions of angels and delivered himself.
Mm-hmm.
But he never drew on that deity for himself personally. Okay, so he's going to rule with the earth, smite the earth, rule with the earth with a rod of iron out of his mouth. And with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. Well, what does that tell you? There will be capital punishment in the millennium.
Oh, yeah.
Because he will slay the wicked.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know, because I don't know at all, what those penalties will be in the context. What is the transgression? What is the sin? It may go back.
Like, how is he going to punish them?
And to what degree of death to slay the wicked? Is it going to be because they murdered somebody? Raped somebody? Just because Christ comes to the earth, we're not at that state when everything is perfect.
Right.
That will
still wickedness.
That's right.
Yeah.
That will happen after the 1,000-year millennial reign. The perfection.
Right.
The new heaven. The new earth and all of that.
No sin.
Death won't even exist anymore. During the millennial reign of Christ, death will still be a reality. People will die.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why this can be difficult to grasp.
Yeah, to understand.
And understand. You say, well, Christ is here. He's on the earth. Yes. But I'll show you here in a few minutes. It will be at the very end when Christ conquers and subdues everything. Everything is made subject to Christ. Once he's conquered everything, everything is put under his feet. He will then render the kingdom back to the Father in its completeness.
And that's after the 1,000 years.
Right. Because in a sense, the process of redemption is still ongoing. The earth has not been redeemed yet. See, that's why in Genesis 8:22, we're told, as long as the earth remains, winter, spring, summer, fall, seed time, and harvest time, that's going to exist.
Right.
If the Lord came today, for the next 1,000 years, the earth would cycle just as
like
it does right now. See?
It's a long time. Yeah,
yeah.
It's hard to fathom.
Well, because we die, 70, 80, 90 years of age, whatever, but multiply that times 10, or 12, 13, 14 if you die at 70. So it's something that we just can't imagine.
Mm-hmm.
You think about your own human body, my age, 66.
You're going to feel like that for 1,000 years.
Well, you're at 30, you have one physicality. At 60, it's another. Well, how will that be in the millennial? Will you have the same physicality at 500 if you live right and you obey the laws of the land and you do as God commands?
Mm-hmm.
How will your body feel? I don't know. Will it be decrepit? I don't think so if you're doing what's right.
Right.
But all evil results are because of sin.
Mm-hmm.
So there'll be people I believe will have longevity, but they may not even be a Christian.
Right. Just kind of how they've lived.
They've lived and they've abided by God's commandments. And so they kept his commandments. Then they received that blessing. They weren't rebels.
Mm-hmm.
They knew not to do this. They knew not to do that. And we're going to get into that in a little bit, how that they're going to be those who are going to rebel against God. They're going to openly rebel.
Yeah.
See? And again, that is not applicable to the church, the body of Christ. Okay, verse 5. Isaiah 11, verse 5, and righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faithfulness the girdle of his reins. So Christ is going to fundamentally for all eternity be two things. He's going to be righteous.
And faithful.
He's going to be faithful. That's who he is now. That's who he's going to be then.
Same yesterday, today, and forever.
That's exactly right. Hebrews 13:8. Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. God does not vary. God does not change. We think he does.
Right.
We assume he does, or he doesn't work it out like we want it to be worked out. So we have a negative feeling toward God.
Yeah.
Like a child toward a parent. Mm-hmm. They took my candy. They went and found what I hid and took it too.
Yeah.
And but see, that's just doing what's right.
Exactly.
And that's as a parent being faithful in the life of that child.
Yeah.
But surely the child doesn't see that.
No, we don't see it at that time.
No. You see it with Salia. She doesn't.
Yeah.
She doesn't see that right now.
No.
Okay, so let's go to Isaiah chapter 65. Isaiah chapter 65, and look at what Isaiah says here. Isaiah gives a lot of things regarding the millennial reign of Christ. So let's go to Isaiah chapter 65. Let's look at the first verse, verse 20. There shall be no more thence an infant of days, nor an old man that hath not filled his days. For the child shall die 100 years old, but the sinner being 100 years old shall be accursed. Mortal men can live
longer,
up to 1,000 years. There'll be children, I believe, born the day Christ comes to the earth. If they live right, do what the Word of God says, I don't even believe they have to be born again. They can live to be 1,000 years of age.
Wow.
However, I believe to go into eternity, this is my personal conviction, they must be born again.
Yeah.
Because you see, sin and that Adamic nature can't go into eternity and eternity be perfect.
Exactly. See, we had to be born again, to make it.
That's right.
Yeah.
But they don't have to be to live 1,000 years.
Yeah.
But to go into eternity with God.
Right.
Because in eternity, there will be no more sin, sickness, disease, death. None of that will exist. That's why, I keep saying this on the radio program. We're not there yet. Everybody's trying to push round pegs into square holes or square pegs
make
into round holes. They're trying to make it work so hard, And when you understand the Bible, certain things have to take place.
Exactly.
And we're not there yet. And what I realize more and more is, guys like me, I'm an aberration to the system. The more people like me die out, the more willing the newer generation is to accept the technology.
Mm-hmm.
People say, you need to get this app. I don't need that app.
Yeah.
I've lived all these years without that
it, app. So why do you need it now?
But well, you need this app.
Yeah.
No, I don't.
No.
See, but that shows me men's minds and their psyche
changing.
Is being influenced to go that way.
Absolutely.
So by the time the mark of the beast gets ready to be manifested,
people
the real mark of the beast, not all the vaccine hyperbole, but the real mark of the beast, we will have come to a state and place it will be acceptable.
You were telling me, too, about a young girl. Well, she was in college, that she didn't know what the 666 or the mark of the beast was. And I'm like, how does somebody not know that? I mean, that was shocking to me.
Yes. But you've had the privilege of being raised in a Christian home.
Yeah.
You've had the privilege for many years sitting under my ministry and hear me preach about these things and write books about these things and talk about these things. These young people don't know anything about it.
Yeah.
It's like I witnessed the explosion of tattoos.
Yeah.
I don't have a tattoo. I'm not castigating anyone who does, but I don't think that's normal.
Right.
I just don't perceive that to be normal in anyone's life.
Yeah.
To deface their body in that manner.
Mm-hmm.
Because the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 3:16, 17, know ye not that you're the temple of God?
Yeah.
And that the Spirit of God dwelleth within you? If any man defile the temple, him will God destroy, for the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. Now don't take that and say, well, Pastor Langford said I'm going to hell because I have a tattoo. I didn't say that. But the Bible does say, don't defile your temple.
Right.
Now, I would say that mostly talks about adultery, fornication, drunkenness, drug abuse.
Right, that's what I was going to say, yeah.
But I'm not going to say the tattoos. But my point is, there's a proliferation.
Right.
In this generation of the acceptance and the wide range of tattoos.
Mm-hmm.
People, body modification, horns. They want to look like the devil. They split their tongues.
That's crazy.
It's absurd.
Yeah.
And my point is, it's getting worse.
Oh, yeah.
And when people like myself are no longer here, that gives them more power to force this.
We want to thank you for tuning in today as we discuss current events from a biblical perspective. Please feel free to send us your questions. Who knows, your question may be the one they discuss on the next edition of Talking It Out. Please send your emails to talkingitout@thevoiceofevangelism.com. Again, talkingitout@thevoiceofevangelism.com. Or write us at Talking It Out, P.O. Box 502, Kayser, North Carolina, 28020. Again, that's P.O. Box 502, Kayser, North Carolina, 28020.
You know, the bank is